Hey, I'm doing a video on the verses that false teachers use out of context to cause fear and doubt because they're not understood through the lens of the Holy Spirit who teaches us all truth. Most of these teachers claim, now let me warn you, any teacher that says we're saved by grace through faith, but don't listen because you're about to get a false gospel that's going to say through one side of their mouth it's faith alone, but it's really not, because they're going to say it's faith alone but faith without works is dead, or it's faith alone but if you have real faith you'll have the works, it's faith alone but you can't live any way you want, it's faith alone but you got to turn from your sins or keep the law, whatever, same thing. Keep the law is to turn from sins, turn from breaking the law, keep the law. So just shut them down. If it's grace through faith but anything, like when Ray Comfort said, you got a whole church, and we're great, saved by grace through faith, but you got a whole church that hasn't repented, so they don't receive salvation till they repent of their sin. Nobody repents of all their sins, ever. And how many sins? If you can't repent of all of them, because you know you can't, because you still sin in your thought, word, and deed every day, you still fail. And if somebody is honest, they'll admit, Ray Comfort, they're not living in holiness. Oh, without which no man shall see the Lord. By the way, that's one they misuse too. I don't have that written down. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord in you. It says, be peaceable unto all men and holy, for without which no man shall see the Lord in you. It's not about you seeing. The holiness required for heaven is a gift of holiness. And it says, and such were some of you, but you were washed, sanctified, which is declared holy, justified. Okay? So they don't get it. All right, by faith alone, because the Gentiles who did not seek to attain righteousness did attain it by faith. And those that were keeping the law or thought they were did not attain righteousness because they tried to attain it by not sinning. Okay, so let me give you some verses here. I will start with this one. For thou art lukewarm, I will spew thee out of thy mouth. Now, when there are tons of very clear verses, we stand on the foundational truth. There's 100 verses that say believe in faith is what saves us. Whoever believes the Son has life. Who believes not the Son has not life, and the wrath of God abides on him. He says, I'll never leave you or forsake you. Nothing will snatch you out of his hands. The work he began in you, he will finish it. He saves us to the uttermost. Whenever we do sin, we have an intercessor who is Christ who liveth to make intercession for us. So when we know that foundational truth, we have to read these things in context. Now, again, these letters in Revelation are written to the angel of the churches, which is the messenger, which is the pastor of the church, okay? When he threatens to take away their lampstand, it means take away their purpose and their ministry. Doesn't mean they're losing salvation, people, because we're not saved by our works. Salvation is for him that worketh not, but believes on him who justifies the ungodly. Not by works of righteousness we have done. It's a free gift, all right? Not of works. Let's see. To the angel of the church of Laodicea write, these things I say to Amen, and the faithful and true witness in the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither hot nor cold. I would that thou were hot nor cold. Now, I've explained before that they say he's the Christ, but they don't really believe he achieved it. What he really achieved. That by himself he purged our sins and sat down at the right hand of majesty. They're adding something to it. This is a false gospel. But in another context here, let's see what he's saying. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with good and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. Okay? When you're cold, you need a blanket. You know what you need. When you're hot, you need an air conditioner or cold water. You know what you need. When you're lukewarm, you just kind of comfy, think you're fine. But they thought they were fine, but they weren't. They were resting in things of the world and not relying on him. They did not, he said, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou may be rich, and white raiment, that thou may be clothed. It is by faith alone, people. This is about him taking away their ministry, their lampstand. He said, I will spew thee out of my mouth because thou art lukewarm, neither cold nor hot. I will spew thee out of thy mouth. When you're cold or hot, you know what you need. But they were lukewarm and didn't even realize what they need. Okay, it has nothing to do with salvation, people. All right, this is a church, a group of people. All right, another one. You see then how that by works a man is justified and not by faith only. Okay, if the entire Bible in the book on salvation says over 100 times it's by believing and believing you might have life through his name, and God so loved the world and he gave his only begotten son, whosoever believeth in him, and then it shall not perish but have eternal life. When it tells you over and over and over again it's believing faith, if something, one or two verses, gives you something that might imply something different, is God the author of confusion? No. James is writing to believers, to people already saved, the 12 tribes of Israel scattered abroad. So who is it? Are they talking about being justified to? Being justified in the eyes of other people. Okay? Because Abraham and Rahab were justified to us because they did the works. Okay? But to God, and it even confirms it at the end, to God we're justified by faith alone. And he closes it by saying, because Abraham believed God and it was counted to him for righteousness, imputed righteousness by faith. But to God, the stories were given over the, people were like, but Abraham was alone. Nobody saw. Okay, the story was told throughout all of Israel. That's how he was justified to men. That's how we know his faith was strong, because we saw it. Another one, another two in James is faith without works is dead and the demons believe. All right, let me explain something here. Dead faith doesn't mean that you're not saved. It means your faith isn't doing the good works and we're saved to do good works. He's rebuking them for just resting and not doing anything to help the needy. And if you read it, it talks about those who are naked and destitute of food. Okay? He said, can faith save them? Save them from what? From hunger and being naked. Thank you. This is about him telling them to do the good works because they're already saved, to show their faith to other people. That's why it says, can you see now that by works a man is justified, not by faith? Only show me your faith by, you show me your faith without works and I'll show you mine with works. Okay? That's what he's saying here. Now, when it says the demons believe and tremble. All right, what do they believe? The demons believe there's one God. That's monotheism, people. That's not the gospel. Plus those entities are dead. Jesus said, whosoever liveth and believeth in me. They're not trusting in the death, burial, and resurrection. Plus they're dead. They're not applicable for salvation. All he's doing is rebuking those lazy people of faith, claiming the faith, and saying, you're acting no better than demons right now because they have faith and they're not doing nothing good either. So technically you're not any better than they are. That's all he's saying. All right. It has nothing to do with your faith alone isn't enough. I'm sick of Ray Comfort using that. All right. Now, let me give you this one. This is a big one. So out of context. I've done tons of stuff on this. For if we sin willfully after we receive the... All right, let me read this in Hebrews. All right. Hebrews is talking about animal sacrifice. All right? Let me even pull that up. All right. This is about rejecting the sufficiency of Christ, the death, burial, and resurrection, and returning to Levitical law after we've received the truth. And it says, if we sin willfully after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there shall remain no more sacrifice for sins. Let's type this in here. Hebrews 10, let's put 10, 20 through 26 in here. See what happens. All right. Read it yourself. I've done a ton of stuff on this. It's about the Jews. It is to the Hebrews people going back to the law and saying that his death, burial, and resurrection was not sufficient, so they still needed to sacrifice animals and go back to the law. And he was explaining that he died once and for all. Let's see this here. It says, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith. They didn't have full assurance of faith. Having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Okay, he even explains in Hebrews, we shouldn't even have a consciousness of sin anymore, having to constantly sacrifice animals, because he died once and for all. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. Okay, he's saying don't waver. Don't be fearful thinking that a sacrifice wasn't enough, because you trample the Son of God underfoot when you do that. Okay, this is not about you sinning, what you sinned on purpose, and so no more sacrifice of sins for your sin. Ridiculous. Ridiculous. All our sins were purged, people. Past, present, and future. All our sins were future when he died. It's ridiculous. Not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as a manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. For if we sin willfully after that we receive the knowledge of the truth, there remain no more sacrifice for sins, because he won't accept those animal sacrifices. And the sin, willful sin here is rejecting the sacrificial death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus and returning to Levitical law to obtain your own righteousness by works. Dead works. He said, let us not lay again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith towards God. This whole book should confirm your faith, not cause fear. See, these people never see God's grace. They never see the sufficiency of the death, burial, and resurrection. They never see it. They only see fear and works. That's all they see. It's ridiculous. And they shipwreck the faith of the saved brethren. I'm so sick of it. All right, another one. Got to endure to the end. Perseverance of the saints. Those are the only ones that will be saved. All right, let me put this in context. Matthew 24:7-13. This is where Jesus is speaking to Israel, to the disciples, about the tribulation period. Okay, the time of Jacob's trouble. And he gives them all these signs, all right? For nation shall rise against nation and kingdom. You got to divide what's to Israel and what's to the body of Christ, people. We've got to do that. A lot of in the four Gospels is to the nation of Israel. For nation shall rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilence and earthquakes, and these are beginning of sorrows. They shall deliver you up to be afflicted and shall kill you and shall be hated of all the nations for my name's sake. And then shall many be offended and shall betray one another and shall hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise and deceive many. And because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. But he that shall endure to the end, the same shall be saved. If they are surviving or enduring at the time he returns, he'll save them from physical death. That has nothing to do with salvation. I am so sick of it being taken out of context. That is about the tribulation period, okay? For the Jews. The Jews, people. All right. Good gracious. Now, all scripture is profitable for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. We should all apply it to our lives, okay? But some mail is not to you. All right, you have to understand, rightly divide the word of truth, okay? You have to know what's about salvation, what's about temporary judgment, what's about, what's to Israel, and what is to the body of Christ, all right? All right, what's some more they got? Oh, examine yourselves that you be in the faith. All right, let me explain that one. He's not saying examine yourselves to see if you're saved. First of all, in context, much false doctrine was coming in. We have to examine ourselves that we're all in the same doctrine. But secondly, in context, people in the Corinthian church were suing each other, brother against brother, okay? He's saying, examine yourselves that you're living your faith, because he gave them instructions on how to love one another. It was one of the commandments. Are you living your faith? Examine yourselves that you're living your faith. That's all it means. That's all it means. It has nothing to do with check yourself to see if you're really saved by your works. Proof of salvation is God's promise that all who believe on the Son shall never die. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And then he said, if you believe in me, whoever believes in me shall never die. Believe thou this? She said, and Martha said, yes, I believe you are the Christ, the Son of God who was to come into the world. So you believe on him. That's what it is. All right. Let's see. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. All right. Does that mean work for your salvation? No. Let me ask you this. If you don't have any legs, can you work out your legs? No. You have to have salvation to work it out. He's saying you're saved, and now you're saved to do good works. So work out that salvation, because you can come under judgment. Judgment of God comes on the house of God first. You see, earthly judgment does. And also, we have to answer to Jesus when we see him face to face with what we did with our faith. What did we do with the gift he gave us? That's all it means, people. You can't work out something you don't have. You can't work out legs if you're an amputee, can you? All right. Now, let me see what else we got here. Oh, don't you know the unrighteous will not inherit? All right, let's go with that one. Who are the unrighteous? Unbelievers. All right? Because he calls them that believed saints. And one was sleeping with a stepmother. They were going to idols and sleeping with temple prostitutes. They were taking of the Lord's Supper unworthily, but they were still called saints. And he even says, don't you know the unrighteous won't inherit? But such were some of you, and you were washed, okay, by faith in the finished work of Christ. But the reason he brings up the unrighteous here is because they were suing each other and taking their cases before the unjust. We're justified by faith alone in the finished work of Christ. But these unbelievers were the unjust and unrighteous. And he's saying, why are you taking your cases before the unjust, unrighteous? Because they won't inherit the kingdom. You'll be judging angels. You should be able to judge yourselves amongst yourselves, because don't you know the unrighteous won't inherit the kingdom? And he lists all the things of the unrighteous. And those people are still defined by their sin. And all unsaved people fall into one of those categories. That's why the list you see, I think it's in Galatians and Revelations, those are all unbelievers, okay? That's a list to show us everyone needs a savior, because everyone lies or has strife. Everyone's covetous, just like Paul said he coveted. That's the one that slew him. Okay, we can't let people take these verses out of context. Oh, here's another one. Repent, or you are also likewise perish. All right, let's read that one. First of all, this is not talking about eternal perishing or salvation. In the context, Jesus was talking about some Galileans who had died in a tower accident, and then Pilate used their death, their blood, to mingle in with their pagan sacrifices. And Jesus said, you think those people were sinners above you? I tell you nay, but if you don't repent, you'll likewise perish. He's saying, if you don't repent, you'll die too. That has nothing to do with eternal salvation. All right, the repentance for salvation is to turn from whatever you trust in, keeping the law or not sinning to save yourself, your dead works, or your idols or false religion or pagan god, whatever. Turn from that to the acknowledgement of the truth, because God grants true repentance, the acknowledgement of the truth, okay? And all of these are about keeping the foundational truth, grace through faith alone in Christ alone. 100% of our faith must be on what Jesus already did. If you don't believe he purged all our sins and that you're not safe, secure forever, you got another gospel. You know, I don't know. Let me see if I've got any more here that I can think of. Examine yourselves, endure to the end, repent or perish. In other words, if you love me, keep my commandments. What does that have to do with salvation? Okay, yeah, if we love him, we should keep his commandments. But does us keeping his commandments, and what were those commandments? Believe on the Son, which is how you love God, by believing the testimony of his Son, and this is the God's report of his Son, eternal life. And eternal life is in his Son. That's how we love God, by believing the testimony of the Son, what he accomplished. Okay, and then to love one another as he loved us. That's it. That's how if you love me, keep my commandments. Love each other and believe on me. That's all he's saying. It has nothing to do with you being saved, people. I'm hoping I answered the main ones people use out of context. And if you keep the King James, it keeps it in context because it's a translation and not an interpretation. There's a man that was starting. First of all, I'd like to let you know that the Spiritist, and thank you, Glenn York, for that wonderful post. The guys that did some of these newer versions were Spiritists, and they used an Alexandrian example, which is a very minuscule amount of translations. It's not the main translation, it's off. And they were Spiritists. They believed in speaking to the dead and familiar spirits and all of that. And they denied a lot of Christ's divinity. They denied the gospel. They denied all of that. Okay? They didn't believe the Bible at all. And then they try to interpret what they think God's saying. God doesn't need your help, okay? And they've removed almost 65,000 words. And the Lord's Prayer is crazy. They're taking out took out half of that. Then they took out the word Godhead, anything that refers to the Trinity. And we know that God, the Godhead, is the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, because all three were present at the baptism of Jesus. This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. That's the Father. Jesus, the Son, was being baptized. And then the Holy Spirit descended as a dove. So we know three yet one. Okay. They also take out anything that says God repented, because it's just a change of mind, or to turn away, or to turn towards something, like turn towards anger, turn from idolatry, whatever. We have to know what we're repenting of. I've said before, you repent of a sandwich and have a salad. You can change your mind about anything, okay? That's all that means. Metanoia, or metaneo, means a change of mind. Repent, rethink, pent, pensive, to be pensive, or pensar in Spanish, to think, rethink, think again. Also, metamelamai means to feel sorry for something, but that's not the word they used. Like to turn from your sin or feel sorry for sin. That's not the word that's used there. It's always change of mind. So we repent of whatever we trust in to trusting on Christ for salvation. I've done tons of videos on that. I hope answering these verses in context will help you. Okay? God bless you guys.